So hello and welcome back to ENG 101 21B workshop 10, and this week we're dealing with complex numbers, or if you want to insult people you can call them imaginary numbers. Now the thing about complex numbers, besides being complex, is only some of you will actually use them. Main people that are going to be using these will be the electronics, the mechatronics and the mechanical students, and the people not using them particularly will be things like civil, environmental, chemical, and materials. But if you're not going to use them, just think of them as a bit of a maths exercise. And yeah, we don't actually like, in this course, we don't like to teach maths that we're not going to use, but we know that at least half of you are going to use this stuff. And yeah, this is a bit of a shortcut. Okay, the story that I heard, and the trouble with stories is, they tend to grow in the telling, is back about the 15th century, or 1500, sorry, they were trying to solve various problems, because the whole point of math back then was to actually apply it to things. And they kept coming up with this problem, and the solution was involved the square root of a negative number. And they had this problem because back in the 1500s, nobody knew what square root of negative one actually was. They thought it was just a garbage solution. And they used to think that these problems were unsolvable. But then, one day, for one of these problems, a mathematician found an alternative solution. So, if they had that thing where if you have a number with negative one, an equation with that in it, and you had another way of finding the same solution which produced real results, that meant the value of negative one must have actually mathematical validity. There must be a way of actually using that so you can get a real solution. So that meant that they now actually were trying to had to figure out, well, these things actually have real value, because you can use them to get real results. Now, think about what we call a complex number. As a complex number has a real amount, like 12 or 26, or it's got a magnitude, and then it's got an imaginary amount. Okay, let's say 7. Let's make that 7. Now, what we can do is we can plot this on a graph. And we can say the real amount is 12, and this is the imaginary axis, and that's going to be have a value of 7, and that's going to give us our magnitude there. Isn't that cool? Now, being engineers, ultimately, we just want this real bit. But we still have to take this into account in our calculations, because if we were then to use this number and multiply it with something later on, it would give us a different result than if we just multiply it by 12. So we do need to take into account. It should be just one thing on the notation here. Often you'll see people use I, and pretty much physicists and anybody except engineers, so mathematicians, physicists, chemists, whatever, use I. Engineers use J. Don't ask me why. So unfortunately, in this course, we sometimes tend to use these two interchangeably. So anyway, we have a real component, and then we have an imaginary component, which we must actually take into account. So the question is, as I said before, they found alternative solutions. So if there are alternative solutions, why do we bother using complex numbers? And the answer is really simple, because it is easier to use complex numbers than use the alternative ways. If the alternative ways are easier, we just use those. But if you can learn the concept of complex numbers, then a lot of the math actually becomes simpler. That's a really cool thing. And then we can apply a lot of the ordinary math that we know. We can add, we can subtract, we can multiply, we can divide, we can do squares, we can do square roots. And so we can then do ordinary, everyday, algebra with complex numbers, and that is often a lot easier than the solution. So, yeah. So half of you are going to be using this stuff on a fairly regular basis, or will at least see it a few more times during your career, your academic career and your real world career. Half of you won't. So, yeah. So just remember, we're now approaching the end. We've got an optional quiz attached. We've got a quiz attached. Tests are going to be online. So just obey all the instructions. Make sure that we can see your work areas, all that type of stuff. Treat them as real exams because they are real exams. Do not be surprised if we do some quality control checks with people. Just ask people to come and have a chat with us. We have to do that now that we're joining SEEM exams. But good luck on the exams. Just usual thing, time management, if you can, do the easy, usual things, easy questions first. Because they'll get, and really important, working. Because remember, you only get part of the mark for the answer. The most of the mark you get for the working. And this is just going to be standard engineering practice for you anyway, because when you do stuff in the real world for money in engineering, people will want to see you working because they will need to cross-check your work. And they will need just to cross-check the maths. There's been plenty of cases where people have not checked the maths and things have fallen down, people have died. So good habits now, show you working out. Try and make it clear so the market can understand what you're actually doing, because that's really important. There's no point in having working like, what's that mean? Just try and make it so we can understand. Good luck in exams, and hopefully I'll see you all in 102. How do we turn this thing off? Gotta be an off switch.